Welcome back to our second session. Hope your discussion was fruitful and that you found that presentation looking at the Holy Trinity, looking at the Paschal Mystery, and how liturgy becomes the way par excellence for us to engage the Trinity and to engage this Paschal Mystery of Christ in the most wonderful way has been enlightening and helpful to you. We're now ready to move to our second portion of the day. And in this particular presentation, we're going to look at three things. We're going to look at some basic principles of liturgical theology. So we're now going to move more concretely into the liturgy itself so that we can kind of understand how it gets put together, the nuts and bolts of the liturgy. We're also going to look at what I call liturgical spirituality. And in that vein, we'll look at four particular dimensions of liturgical spirituality that we experience every time we come together for Mass on Sunday. And then lastly, I'd like to look at some of the cultural influences that are brought into liturgical theology and liturgical spirituality and how they help and sometimes how they inhibit our appropriation of a great experience of worship. And so that'll be our agenda for this second session. And so I'd like to begin with some basic elements of liturgical theology. And if we don't get these, then we're like the batter at bat, and the pitchers are going by us. The goal is for you to bat at least 270 by the end of these presentations today. In worship, we believe that we encounter the Holy Trinity both transcendentally, there's your 50-cent word for the day, and immanently, that's your 40-cent word for the day. What do those words mean? They're very important to us as Catholics. Transcendentally means that we are experiencing the God who is vertical, the otherness of God, the unknowable God, the unseen God. That is this God of the universe. But at the same time, we also in the sacred liturgy encounter God immanently. Again, to use the expression from St. Augustine, that God is closer to us than we are to ourselves. And so this is the God who is known. This is the God who is seen. This is the God that we experience through our senses. We believe as Catholics that the fundamental purpose of worship is to praise and glorify God. It has been my experience for many years. I was one of the floater priests of the diocese. When I was working in the vocations office, I would often be invited by pastors to substitute for them when they needed to get away for vacation, or were going to a conference, or just needed some extra help for a particular occasion. And it's fascinating to me, as I have visited probably a good number of the parishes around the diocese in my 30 years of priesthood, I'm not always convinced that praising and worshiping God is the highest priority of every person in our pews. Now, there's a part of me that hopes that it is, but I want to make it crystal clear that unless praise and worship of God is really our first and foremost purpose for being at worship, then there's some homework that needs to be done. There's some evangelization. There's some awareness that needs to be achieved on the part of those who sit in our pews. I can speak from my own experience. It is not unusual for me from time to time to be looking out over my congregation and seeing somebody on a cell phone, or to see somebody engaged in a little cuddling with the person next to them, usually a boyfriend or a girlfriend. They're trying to use this time as an opportunity, because the parents are probably two or three rows ahead of them, to spend a little time having a little enjoyableness with the person that they are falling in love with. And while there's a certain value to that, I'm not exactly sure that that's the highest and foremost reason for coming to worship. But we're human beings, and I'm always grateful that at least they're in the pews. They're there, they've shown up, and hopefully, little by little, we can catch them in terms of what it is that we're trying to do in the sacred liturgy. But in worship, we encounter this Holy Trinity, both transcendentally and immanently. The fundamental purpose of our worship is to praise and glorify God. It is also an opportunity for us to pray for ourselves and for others. And indeed, some of the great feedback that I hear from parishioners at worship is that they really appreciate having the time to be able to come in a house of worship to ask God for help, to pray for the needs of their family, their friends, their colleagues at work, to pray for the needs of the bigger church, the bigger world, those who live on the margins of life. We also come to worship to increase our sense of community. And this is very important for us, as particularly in our North American context. What we are trying to do at the Sacred Liturgy is to develop a sense of who we are as a corporate body, who we are in our oneness. Unfortunately, the challenge for us is that we live in a culture where our individualism is given an awful lot of priority. And so I sometimes wonder what goes on in worship in terms of, are we having a corporate act of worship, or are we having a group activity in which everyone is doing his or her own thing at the same time? Here are a couple of images that I use to help me to grasp this. I follow a particular basketball team pretty well known in this state and throughout this country. A couple of years ago, they won a national championship. And the coach bragged, after they had won the championship, that the thing that really distinguished them during that year was the fact that they played as one. They played as a team. Now, last year, they didn't do so well. And the same coach said he had a terrible time trying to get them to play as a team. Rather, what he was dealing with was everybody was out there playing the same game, but they were all playing it on their own terms. And he had a terrible time getting them to understand that they had to surrender their individuality in order for the team to be successful. Those of you who work in music ministry know what this is about also. I'm a musician by my background before I studied for the priesthood, and in fact, worked as a professional church musician for a couple of years. And the church I inherited in my first job was a church that had a very nice choir, about 50 voices. But what I discovered as soon as I got there was that I had 50 voices and not a choir. And so one of the things I had to do right from the beginning was to get them to understand that they were functioning as a body, not as 50 individuals. And slowly but surely, this one had to be a little quieter, this one had to be a little louder. This one was in a bad position, had to move over here because she needed to listen to the person next to her to make sure she was on pitch. And as they learned how to help each other, and they learned how to interact with one another and form a team, a true choir, their performance improved, back in the days when it was back in the choir loft. And it was truly a wonder to watch this whole transformation, a group of individuals becoming one body. And that's what we attempt to do at worship. It's a lot of work to do that. And getting everybody on that same plate is a challenge. But that is one of our purposes of worship. We come to praise and glorify God. We come to pray for ourselves and for others. And we come to increase our sense of community of faith because it reflects the Trinity. Why do we bother to become one? Because the Trinity is one. And that becomes our measure against which we try to live our own lives. If we come to worship to praise God, to pray for one another and ourselves, and to grow in the sense of community, we begin to see that fruit appears from our worship. First and foremost, God is glorified. And in that glorification, true worship is given. And we become closer to God, and God becomes closer to us, if that can be even imaginable. But secondly, one of those fruits is the sanctification of humanity. We become a holier people. We become more Christ-like in our life. Another notion of the liturgy that is important to note is a sense of time. And I find that this is a very helpful way for people to understand better what is happening at Mass. As you know, we live in the Bible Belt. I grew up here in North Carolina, and as a child growing up in the 50s and the 60s, I had to defend my faith pretty strongly when North Carolina was less than 1% Catholic. The high school I graduated from, there was one other Catholic student in my whole high school graduating class of almost 600 students who was a Catholic. All of my friends were Protestants, and all of them were constantly on me about why I belonged to that weird Catholic religion. And of course, one of the big issues for them was about this whole sense of Jesus being in bread and wine. That was always a big fascination for them. It still is. It's still the number one question I get asked by my Protestant friends, including Protestant minister friends. They like to understand, how do you Catholics believe all of this? And so I find that over the years, this explanation of time really has helped to demythologize for a lot of people this notion of real presence and what it is that happens at the liturgy and why how we pray, the rituals we use, the words we use, the gestures, why all of those things are done with a certain precision in order for us to, in effect, have an experience of the real presence of Christ in our midst. And so I'd like to speak a few moments about two Greek words. We're going to have another vocabulary learning moment here. The first word is chronos, and the second word is kairos. Chronos and kairos. Chronos is the word we use for chronological. It's a sense of linear time. It is that past, present, future line on which all of us live. At some point earlier today, your alarm bell went off, a dog was in your face, a spouse was rubbing up against you, or a small child perhaps was asking for breakfast. At some point, you awoke. That's a past event. It will never be repeated again. And now you're here in this moment, listening to this presentation and trying to learn a little bit more about the sacred liturgy. And at some point, blissfully in the not-too-distant future, you'll be getting out of here and moving on with your day. That's a future event. And so we live in this sense of linear time, past, present, and future. And so that's known as chronos in the Greek language. There's also another sense of time that we refer to as kairos, K-A-I-R-O-S. Kairos time is multidimensional. Some have described it as being that all time is eternally present. It is God's time. God is not bound by chronological time like we are. For God, 10 million years ago is as present to God as 10 million years in the future. It's all present to God because God is not bound by a sense of linear time as we are. And so in the liturgy, what we experience are both of these kinds of times coming together. They merge and become one. This is a very important principle of liturgical theology, the sense of time. And so what happens is that when chronos and kairos meet, the past becomes present. And for us, the most important event of the past that becomes present for us is Calvary. It is that scene from Mel Gibson's The Passion of the Christ, where not only is his resurrection present, but also present to us is his passion and death. The entire Paschal mystery becomes a present reality for us in the here and now. And in the next presentation, I'll explain a little bit more about how that happens in terms of the language, the symbols, and the gestures that we use in the Eucharistic prayer. But what we also find experiencing in the liturgy is that it makes the future present for us. We are people who live for the future as Christians. And what is that future? The kingdom of God. And what is the kingdom of God? I love asking this question to people. What is the kingdom of God? We hear it all the time. What does it really mean? Well, here's an answer that I've come up with. Eternal happiness, ecstasy, joy, where all live in peace and harmony without struggle, rivalry, or betrayal, and there's no more death. Now, if you don't want that, please go someplace else. But I don't know about you, but I like that idea. I want to be part of that kind of a place. I want to be in that kind of a kingdom. And that's what Jesus inaugurated in the world when he became incarnate, lived among us, ministered among us, suffered, died, and rose from the dead. That kingdom became present to us. Not fully, but it became present to us. It became available to us. We began this journey to be able to have that. And so in the sacred liturgy, what happens because of this Chronos and Kairos merging together is that we have this opportunity to have a taste of this eternity, this kingdom of God, this reign of God that Jesus preached about throughout his ministry, his public life as a human being. And so in the liturgy, the past becomes present. In the sacred liturgy, the future becomes present. I want to move on now to a little bit in the area of liturgical spirituality. As we all know, there are different schools of spirituality. There's Ignatian spirituality. St. Ignatius of Loyola, the founder of the Jesuits. His school of spirituality is referred to as Ignatian spirituality. For those of you who are close to the Franciscan communities in our diocese, you are probably well aware of the spirituality of St. Francis of Assisi. We call it Franciscan spirituality, very creation-based, holistic, etc. Then there are other kinds of spirituality, like Carmelite spirituality. And then we know that there are different kinds of liturgical spiritualities, ecclesial expressions of spirituality, for example, that are of a devotional nature, praying the rosary, making the stations of the cross, praying the Divine Mercy Chaplet. These become other ways for people to express through liturgical and ritual language their spirituality. All of these schools are very viable, wonderful, and have a great place in our church, in our church world. But there is one spirituality that overarches all of them, and that's liturgical spirituality. The church herself describes the sacred liturgy as the church's spirituality, because it applies to everyone and is intended to be prayed by everyone. At Vatican II, the second Vatican Council, the bishops of the world wrote in the first document to be promulgated from that council, the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy, in paragraph 10, I believe, that the liturgy is the summit and the source the summit towards which the activity of the church is directed, and at the same time, it is the fountain from which all her power flows. And so even the bishops themselves at Vatican II took great pains to point out to the whole world the importance of liturgical spirituality as the overarching spirituality for all of us. This is one of the reasons why the liturgy is so important to us. And so having this sense of liturgical spirituality as being the church's spirituality, I'd like to look at four particular expressions of that spirituality that you experience each and every time you come to Mass. If the sacred liturgy is the church's spirituality, how does it get expressed? I would like to propose four ways to you: biblical spirituality, incarnational spirituality, ecclesial spirituality, and evangelical spirituality. I'm going to break these four points down for you now. We believe spirituality is the living interaction between God and people. It's the relationship. It's the bond that exists between God and us. What's key to understanding spirituality is that it is a living experience. Imagine you're married, but you do not love your spouse. That would be a hard relationship to maintain, because the thing that keeps it alive, love, is not present. And so what we do at liturgy is not simply empty ritual. We just don't go through the motions. This for us is a living experience. And that's really a critical word here to understand. It is alive. It is living. And so I'd like to look at these four dimensions of spirituality that we experience in the church's liturgy to look at how each and every one of them is a living experience of our relationship with God and with one another. Moses tells us in the book of Deuteronomy, not on bread alone does a person live, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm not sure that I would want to live only on the Word of God. I would get hungry pretty fast. And while I know that that Word of God would feed my soul, I know that my body would pretty soon be saying, well, thank you for sharing, but I think I need to get a hamburger right now, or I need to have a bowl of cereal. I need to have something to drink, because that's just how we're made. But I think Moses is revealing something to us very profound about the importance of the Word of God. It is not on bread alone that we live, but on every word that comes from the mouth of God. What does that mean, every word that comes from the mouth of God? What it means is this: God's Word nourishes us. Why? Because it is a living thing. It is alive. It does something. If you will open your Bible to the book of Genesis, chapter 1, you don't get too far into the book of Genesis when you begin to read these words, "And God said, etc., etc., and so it happened." And so by God's speech, by God's proclaimed word, something happens. Something is live. God's word creates on the first day, on the second day, on the sixth day. And every time God speaks, something happens. We believe that's true of the liturgy of the word, where we express biblical spirituality par excellence in our Mass. I love these words from St. Augustine, and I have reflected on them often over the course of the years. Here's what St. Augustine had to say about the importance of the Word of God. He said, "Brothers and sisters, here is a question for you. Which of you seems the greater, the Word of God or the body of Christ? If you want to give the right answer, you will reply that God's Word is no less than Christ's body. Therefore, just as we take care when we receive the body of Christ so that no part of it falls to the ground, so likewise should we ensure that the Word of God which is given to us is not lost to our souls because we are speaking or thinking about something different. One who listens negligently to God's Word is just as guilty as one who, through carelessness, allows Christ's body to fall to the ground." It would be interesting to take a survey of the people who sit in our pews on Sunday as to how many of them would share St. Augustine's perspective on the living Word of God. My parishioners make fun of me. And actually, almost in any parish I've been in long term, my parishioners have made fun of me and have given me a bit of grief, because I'm pretty fussy that when the first scripture begins to be proclaimed from the ambo, anybody who's come walking into the church, we all know they're going to be latecomers, we will wait and make sure that they're all seated. We will make sure that people are still, people have settled down. Why? because God is about to speak to us. And they get people will look at me because they'll see somebody will, it's sort of like they escaped and they figured out how to get into church, and now they're walking down, because you know all the seats that are left are now down in front. And so now they've got to walk all the way down to the front of the church in order to get to that seat. And they're like a man on a mission here. They are going to get to that seat as best they can. And they don't care what else is going around. They kind of hunker down and they're going to that seat. But in the meantime, as they're walking down, everybody's attention is drawn to that person. It's just human nature. And so the Word of God ends up being neglected. And so these are very practical ways in which we look at how we give reverence to the Word of God, which is living. As it is being proclaimed by the lector, it is a living thing. It is part of our spirituality. And Augustine, I think, captures that sense very poignantly as he compares it to what for us would be par excellence, the greatest presence of Christ in our midst, Holy Eucharist. This is simply an image of a gospel book being carried in procession to the ambo, being held aloft as an alleluia is being sung with full voice by the whole community to give prominence to this word that we will soon hear from the Lord Jesus himself. This is another example of the proclaimed word. The first and second readings and the psalm response are proclaimed from the ambo. In my way of thinking, it would be rare that the psalm would not be proclaimed from the ambo, because it too is the Word of God. It's just simply being sung. But it is the Word of God. I have found that even in explaining it in that language to my parishioners, that some have said to me, you know, I never thought about the psalm as being the Word of God. And of course, they say, when you think about it logically, of course it is. But I just never thought about it because it was always being sung. And it was being sung from sometimes off to the side. So we brought the cantor up to the ambo to proclaim Scripture through the gift of song, through the medium of song, to proclaim God's presence. Again, it becomes living. What are some of the challenges that we face if Scripture is a form of divine revelation for us? What are some of the challenges to the reception of grace, God's love, deeper meaning, love that we look for fundamentally? Remember those two questions that I presented to you in the first session? Does my life have meaning? Who's going to love me? How is it that the Word of God conveys those two truths? And how is it that they become challenging, difficult to convey because of a contemporary world in which we live? I want to propose to you a few things for us to be aware of, so that we can, again, just be attentive to how these things help us when we're standing at bat to either get a hit or to have a miss. I think, first of all, one of the things we have to deal with, the reality on the ground for us, is that we suffer from word pollution. We live in a world that is bombarded with words. The English language has one of the richest vocabularies in the world. But I am fascinated as I listen to radio, watch television, how many programs are simply all talk and talk and talk and talk. And to the point that I think it's harder and harder for us to listen. A friend of mine who's a Southerner always used to say to me when I was a child growing up, she said, you know what, you never learn anything when you're talking. And that was her way to try to get me to pay attention to the fact that I needed to shut up. You don't learn anything when you're talking. And so this art of listening is very important for us. But when we live in a world that's bombarded with words, and sometimes we can be contributors to that pollution, it becomes hard for us to disengage from being in that active mode or simply having that noise pollution coming at us all the time to be able to distill all of it to hear God speak to us in the sacred Scriptures. I think another challenge that we face is just the nature of the Bible itself. It uses archaic words. It uses a grammatical structure and a genre of writing that can leave us mystified and can appear detached from our world. I don't know about you, but there are many times because I preach, I spend time all week with these scripture passages. And so I'm reading the commentaries in the background and I'm praying over them. And so by the time I get to the weekend liturgy, I really do know these words pretty well. But for the average person coming into the church on Sunday, it's the first and only time they're going to engage that word. Now, I don't know about you, but I can imagine that if I walked into a church on most Sundays and listened to the first reading, I would have absolutely no idea what is going on. Because the way the lectionary has been prepared, that passage has been lifted from a book in the Hebrew Scriptures generally, except during the Easter season. But we don't generally get the context. We don't know where this is coming from. We don't know why it's been placed here. We don't know what goes before it and what goes after it. And so that word can become blah, blah, blah to us. And so sometimes it's just the nature of the lectionary or even the way it's positioned in the liturgy that can make it difficult for us to engage it, to have this living experience of spirituality. Another challenge I think we face is that we live in a scientific world where the empirical sciences generate skepticism as a starting point for us. You've got to prove this to me. Any of you who work with young people know exactly what I'm talking about. You've got to prove it to me. That's not a bad question. But if it's your starting point all the time, you don't come to the liturgy with a sense of, I'm here to receive. Rather, I'm coming here to scrutinize. Who's in charge? If I come to receive, I'm acknowledging the fact that I'm the recipient. I'm the beneficiary. But if I come with an attitude of skepticism, I want to scrutinize this. I'm now in the active mode, and I'm the person who really is in charge. In the spiritual life, that doesn't help you to engage the living relationship with God. My practical experience of this has been working with both an English-speaking community and an immigrant Spanish-speaking community. I find that those who come to us from our Hispanic immigrant communities are much more receptive to the Word of God. I find that the volume of noise decreases dramatically when the scripture readings are being proclaimed, more so than I find, generally speaking, in the English-speaking communities. And I think it's simply because many of our Hispanic immigrants are coming out of a world where still to engage the Word of God is a fascination. And they come out of a worldview, out of a culture, where being recipients of this Word is still a more expected experience for them. That's part of their worldview. I think one of our other challenges is also the art of listening. Listening to the proclaimed Word is difficult. Why? Well, I think increasingly in the West, we are becoming visual learners. It's one of the reasons why I'm using a PowerPoint with this presentation with you, because I know to hear a lot of words over the course of a long period of time can become tedious for us very quickly. Plus, we are just simply increasingly becoming more of a visual learner. We appreciate being able to see these words, to see images, to help us to be engaged. I think one of our other challenges is that we are living more and more in a multitasking world. And in a world where we're multitasking, I think it's harder for us to focus on one thing at a time for an extended period of time. We've become culturally adapted. Darwin would probably have some interesting things to say about this, around the television commercial. Our attention span. This has all been scientifically studied and researched. Our attention span, younger and younger ages, is about the same length of time between commercials on a television program. Why? Because that's the principal way in which they are engaging the world. I'm fascinated when I'm working with younger people, but even children especially, in terms of trying to get them to focus on something and to stay at it for just a little bit longer than they're accustomed to doing that. It's hard for them because they live in a world of multitasking. And so this too can become an obstacle for engaging the Word of God. One of our other real problems is simply our delivery system. It can be mediocre. It can actually be poor. We've all heard lectors who we have, when they finish that passage, we have absolutely no idea what they've just said to us. Some sound like they've got marbles in their mouths. Some can't speak up. Some have a difficulty enunciating so that the words are clearly understood. Some simply just read too fast. And it goes by us. I teasingly referred to one of my lectors after he's finished. I said, now, next week, I want you to talk New York, North Carolina speed and not New York speed. And if you'll do that, those of us who listen at North Carolina speed will be able to hear what you said a little bit better. Now, it's a joke between the two of us, and he does laugh, and he says, I'm trying to learn. He says, I think I got down to about Maryland this time. I said, well, yeah, it was good. It was better. He said, but the goal is to get you down to North Carolina here, so slow down just a little bit more. So sometimes just the delivery, sometimes our sound systems are terrible. I can't tell you how many churches I've been in where the sound system is extremely compromised in terms of its effectiveness for everybody even to be able to hear the word, or to even hear it with clarity. And then there are the eternal distractions during the liturgy of the word. There are the latecomers, there's the crying child, there are the people talking to each other. And so when these happen, we have an inhibited opportunity to engage God in what we call biblical spirituality. But when it is successful, faith grows, people have profound experiences, and they say, you know what, my life's been changed because of this encounter. The next thing I'd like to do would be look at what's called incarnational spirituality. This is where we get our understanding of sacrament from in our Catholic tradition. Some of you, not many, but some of you are old enough to remember the days of the Baltimore Catechism. And good old question number 15 is a very important question right at the very beginning of the Baltimore Catechism. Where is God? As little children, we all learn God is everywhere. God is everywhere. And that's a fundamental belief for us as Catholics. It's the heart of what we believe in terms of our understanding of what is called incarnational spirituality. We believe that the incarnation of Jesus restores dignity to humanity. Jesus' incarnation, coming in the flesh, restores dignity to all of humanity because God deemed the human body worthy to live in. And again, for our young people who sometimes mightily struggle with their sense of self-image, I think this is a very important thing for us to help them to come to accept and believe that their body is a holy thing, who they are. They don't have to be a runway model or a handsome athlete. Just because you have a body, you have dignity, because it's the same kind of a body that Jesus inhabited. This is why we bow our heads during these words in the Creed. And these are the words we will pray in the Revised Missal. For us men and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. It is from the incarnation that we understand our theology of grace. Namely, that grace builds on nature. Grace builds on nature. What does that mean? That means that grace, which is God's love, is able to, in a sense, adhere to, connect to, be one with our human nature. And so something that is all holy, all pure, all good, is going to adhere to anything, you would think it has to be similar. And in fact, that's what our theology believes, is that our human nature is good, holy. And therefore, grace builds on that. Now, our Calvinist friends take a different perspective on that. And they would disagree with us strongly that grace builds on nature. Because our Calvinist friends would say our nature is bad. It's fatally flawed. We would say, well, we make mistakes. We do wrong. Yes, we sin. But we're not fatally flawed. We're not. Why? Because Jesus became incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. I love the way the British poet Hilaire Belloc describes it. Where'er the Catholic sun doth shine, there's always laughter and good red wine. At least I've always found it so. Benedicamus Domino, which means let us give thanks to God. And so Hilaire Belloc, wonderful British poet, really describes the nature of our incarnational spirituality. We don't have problem having a glass of wine. I love being around Hispanics, Italians, because they sort of have this gusto for life that wasn't part of my upbringing. I don't come from a Mediterranean country. My ancestors don't. I'm from the northern part of Europe, where we tend to be a little bit more on the uptight side. But I find it in being with my Hispanic friends, my Italian friends, a good glass of wine, a good party, a good laugh, good storytelling, lots of food, a little mangia bene all the time. These are things that make us very Catholic. And all this is simply a celebration of life and the goodness that is part of our life. In the realm of liturgical theology, we believe that we celebrate this incarnational spirituality. A sidebar, and this is about what liturgy is not. Sometimes people have this sense that liturgy is a cultic activity, and I'd like to clarify that a little bit, because I think people don't understand what that means. A cultic activity is understood to be an activity to gain entrance to a world normally closed off to us. And so, for example, in the Aztec religion, they used to sacrifice virgins to a supreme deity on a particular day of the year. Why? To appease that angry god and thereby gain favor from that god. We don't believe that. We don't believe that we have to do those things to gain the favor of God. God wants us to have that favor because we are God's favorites already by virtue of the fact that we just simply exist. And so liturgy, if we're to understand it more correctly, is in fact a ritual activity. For us, it discloses the God who is always already in our midst, but not always understood and perceived in our midst. Again, God is closer to you than you are to yourself, 24/7. And liturgy becomes a way for us to simply become aware of this, to become aware of the God who is always already in our midst, to a forgetful and sometimes unaware people. We all suffer, to some extent, from amnesia. We keep forgetting, which is why we come back to liturgy over and over again. People say, it's the same thing week after week. Yes, it is. Now, there are different changes, different music, different scriptures, different prayer texts. But yes, it's in its structure, it is the same every week. But I need that structure because I need to be reminded of what that structure tells me about who I am. Why? Because I can get caught up in my life just as much as you can to the point that I forget who I am, who I really am in the eyes of God. The American bishops have put it in another way. They've said to us, we do not come to meet Christ as if he were absent from the rest of our lives. We come together to deepen our awareness of and commitment to the action of God's Spirit in the whole of every moment. The bishops wrote that in their first document on church music after Vatican II was concluded, a document called Music in Catholic Worship. Incarnational spirituality has profound implications for us. In terms of our spiritual life, It tells us that our life is lived out, that the spirit of our life, the life of the Spirit is lived out in the ordinariness of our life. You don't have to go to the mountain. You don't have to go to the beach. In the ordinariness of your life, you may live out your spiritual life. As a result of this, we believe that our ordinary life becomes extraordinary because God is part of it. Our conflict will be if we have a mentality that believes that God is somehow absent, somehow disconnected, somehow unhappy with creation. And again, I would propose to you that that is not a Catholic mentality. We don't believe that God is ever absent, disconnected, or unhappy with us. Now, he's not thrilled to death with everything that we do or don't do, but God is never unhappy with us, absent or disconnected. And because of that sense of the incarnational principle, we believe that ordinary things in the liturgy disclose the extraordinary. And so water and oil and bread and wine and gestures like laying on of hands disclose the ordinary. God is always already in our midst. And these rituals and gestures disclose that presence in tangible ways so that we can experience it. All of you have had experiences of listening to music that has moved you to the depths of your being when you've been at church. It might have been the words. It might have been the music itself. It might have been the voice, the quality of the singer or of the artist who was performing it on an instrument, that haunting melody of an oboe. There was something there that just, it grabbed you. And it was in that moment you had an incarnational experience of God. In terms of the liturgy, in terms of this incarnational principle, we also believe that just as ordinary things like water and oil and bread and wine disclose the ordinary, that we too are bearers of God's presence. We too are bearers of God's presence. Each and every one of you has the potential to be a bearer of God's presence. You don't have to be a priest. You don't have to have advanced degrees in theology. You are very much, as much, if not more so than I sometimes, a bearer of real presence to one another. As a result of that, we've seen some shifts in the way we celebrate our liturgical life. This is just simply an image of a baptism in a church where they have the ability to immerse the candidate for baptism completely underwater. We've moved away from a minimalistic approach to sacramental signs because we believe that people experience the presence of God more strongly when the symbols themselves are abundant and full in their ritualizing. I remember the first time I ever baptized an adult in a full immersion pool. This was a big, burly, masculine, macho guy who had been real macho and tough through the whole RCIA. When he got pulled out of that water, he was like a little baby. And he kept it together, but I could see in his face that something had happened to him. And when we met a couple days later to do some unpacking of the Easter vigil, I'll never forget his words. He said, "When I was in that water," he said, "I understood for the first time what it meant to die and to rise." And he said, "And it felt so good." He said, "I was seduced by the water. I was seduced by the water." And it does when it's that lavish and that full. Be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit. A lavish anointing of the forehead with sacred chrism clearly proclaims the gift of the Spirit upon the one being confirmed. This is Father John Durbin, one of our parishes in the diocese, and I have watched him confirm. I'm amazed that the person doesn't actually slip out of the pew after they sit down after he's finished anointing them on the forehead. He really does like to lather them up a little bit. And then for us as Catholics, you know, that whole notion of the Eucharist, the body of Christ, amen. The Paschal mystery made present in ordinary bread and wine is given to the people of God to assist them in their lives. Jesus Christ nourishes us with his body and blood so that we might never forget how loved we are by God. As St. Augustine has said, become what you eat. And in fact, we do. The third form of spirituality I'd like to look at in this presentation is what is referred to as ecclesial spirituality. This third school reflects the truth that Christ is both head and members. We believe that God, the call of God, is always to a people, even when it is initially to an individual. Think of Moses, think of Noah, think of the prophets, think of John the Baptist. They were all individually called by God, but ultimately they were called by God for the good of others. This makes sense to us when we think about the truth that God is Trinity. And in the sacred liturgy, it reconnects individuals to community in various ways. And so think about this in terms of the way we pray the liturgy. We pray for the Pope, for our local bishop, for the sick, for the dead, etc., in our prayers of the faithful, and in our Eucharistic prayer. We pray the Our Father. We have communal activities, such as singing and processing, bowing, standing through communion, and all of these become a visible witness of our unity. We also have our communal responses, Amen, thanks be to God, etc. And so in ecclesial spirituality, we go from an experience of a bunch of individuals all gathered together, a group of individuals bringing their own candle into the church from the Easter fire, going to the collective light that dispels the darkness when all that light comes together. And it is in that sense that we understand, in a way that we can't in any other time of the year, our oneness as the light of Christ. By the way, there is no light, no artificial light coming into that room, into that church. All that light you see in that room is because of the candles the people are holding. Truly an inspiring experience. In terms of ecclesial spirituality, its purpose is to strengthen our sense of hope. In a world that is not always a hopeful place, in households where there is darkness, loneliness, discord, it is important that we receive hope. When we are in solidarity as the people of God in the liturgy, we participate in Christ dying and rising, his paschal mystery, and we experience ourselves rising from our darkness, rising from our loneliness, rising from our discord. It is not always easy because of the challenges of our culture. Our culture would prefer that that it be all about us. It's Burger King land. You can have it your way. But the liturgy says, no, surrender your ego so that you might know this ecclesial spirituality that is so important to us as Catholics. Another struggle we face is we live in a culture of consumerism and entertainment. It is difficult to resist this culture because it is so pervasive and it is around us 24/7. I feel badly sometimes for musicians. I live in a county where we have a number of the mega churches, where the featured focus of their worship is the rock band. And I know of Catholics who have said, "Father, I go to that church because I really dig rock and roll music." So when you challenge them a little bit more and say, "Well, and so what else is there about all of that?" You don't find a whole lot more. And so we have. But they're seduced by the rock and roll music, and that's enough for them. And so we have a culture that suggests to us that we are to be consumers and we are to be entertained. The other challenge I think we face is, in a highly privatized society, our desire for privacy, which is not rooted in our tradition. These are challenges to ecclesial spirituality. And finally, our fourth point and final about this liturgical spirituality, I refer to it as evangelical spirituality. We come to this last period, and we believe that when we leave the sacred liturgy, we are different than when we arrived. Hopefully we're better. Sometimes we're not. But we are not the same as we were when we walked through the door. We have become the privileged location of the body of Christ. Christ has come to dwell in us anew. And having embraced the gospel and its values, we go out into the world to invite others to embrace this God who loves them also. Now, I don't know about you, but there's the sinful me that has a tendency to resist this outward movement because I prefer comfort and life on my own terms. I do like Burger King's motto. I do want to have it my way. And I think we all do to some extent. And so that's the challenge for us in this evangelical spirituality. The liturgy calls us by its nature to go out into the world and to change it, to do something to make it better. And so we're continually confronted with the truth that the Eucharist is primarily to change you and me, and not just bread and wine. And so what changes are occurring? That's what the liturgy is attempting to do. Ultimately, we are reminded in the sacred liturgy that we are people of mission, and that the divine missioner will take us to places we would rather not go and to people with whom we would not normally associate. And if that's not happening for you, I would suggest that perhaps you need to be stretched a little bit in the evangelical spirituality of the liturgy. The evidence is found ritually in the way that we are dismissed from Mass. And so in the new Missal, we will see these words being given to us at the end of Mass. Go forth. The Mass is ended. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. That's pretty explicit. And lastly, go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life. And so we leave the table of the Word, we leave the table of the Eucharist, and we go to the tables of the world. And those tables await us. It may be the table of a soup kitchen. It may be the table in a refugee camp. But no matter where that table might be, we are called to from both the table of the Word and the table of the Eucharist into those words. And so as we come to the conclusion of this time, I invite you now to explore these four questions under the direction of your facilitator as time permits.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours,